Hello everyone, in this lecture I am going to deal the placental circulation with a various illustration. So in the placental circulation there are the two flowing system, one the blood which is coming from the mother and it is flowing through the placenta and going back toward the mother, that is called the uteroplacental circulation or the maternal circulation, and the another system is called the fetoplacental circulation. It means the blood is flowing from the fetus and it is moving around the placenta and going back toward the fetus. So that is called the fetoplacental circulation. So before I start, I suggest you that you just go and watch my previous video of the structure of placenta, because without knowing the basics of the structure of placenta, you won't be able to understand the circulation. Firstly, I show you the image by which you can easily understand what is the blood supply of the uterus, and then I will show you how the blood is flowing from the mother and then it goes into the placenta and returning back toward the mother. So here in this image you can see the blood supply of the uterus, and you know that there are the three layers of the uterus. The outermost is the perimetrium, and in the perimetrium you can see here there is the uterine artery, that is the branch of the anterior division of internal iliac artery. So this branch pierces the perimetrium and goes inside the myometrium, and once it goes inside, this forms the arcuate artery. So what is this one? This is the arcuate artery, and in the myometrium itself, this arcuate artery branch off, and there this artery forms the radial artery, and then this radial artery pierces the innermost lining of the uterus, that is the endometrium, and once it pierces, it again branch off. One, it forms the smaller basal artery, and the another one with a spiral artery. So here it is the spiral artery which basically supplies the decidua, that is the endometrium of the pregnant uterus. So there are 120 to 200 spiral arteries that pierces the basal plate. So you can see here it is the basal plate. This is the basal plate. We already discussed about it, that the basal plate is inner lining of the placenta that forms the decidua basalis. So many spiral arteries randomly piercing that basal plate and supplies the endometrium. Now we'll see the another image, that how these spiral arteries supply the placenta. So here in this you can see these are the spiral arteries that flows inside the intervillous space. As you know that there are the finger like projections in the placenta that are called the coronic villi, and the space in between the villi are called the intervillous space. So blood is coming through these spiral arteries and comes inside the intervillous space. In a placenta there is about 500 ml of blood which is present, and out of 500 there is 150 ml lying inside the intervillous space, and 350 ml blood is lying inside the villous system. So roughly you can say that around 500 to 600 ml of blood in a minute is circulating around this intervillous space. So that is about 3 to 4 times this blood is replacing in every minute. Now you can see here there are the trophoblastic cell which take part in the formation of the villi, that is the syncytiotrophoblastic cell as well as the cytotrophoblastic cell which take part in formation of villi. But there are other type of cytotrophoblasts or this trophoblastic cell which do not take part in the formation of villous system. So these cells are called extravillous trophoblast. And in extravillous trophoblast, let me show you the image. And in extravillous trophoblast also there are the two type, interstitial as well as endovascular extravillous trophoblast. So extravascular because they are not taking part in the formation of villi system, and they are just invading the decidual lining, as well as somehow these invading inside the myometrium as well. So as the name suggests, endovascular. So in this you can see these are the endovascular, that the cells which invading inside the vessels, that is the spiral arteries. So the cell, that is the cytotrophoblast, which invade inside these vessel are called endovascular extravillous trophoblast. So there are the two waves of invasion. First wave usually invade after the fertilization within 12 weeks of gestation. Within 12 weeks of gestation, the cytotrophoblastic cells which invade inside this vascular system. So in this image you can see the interstitial extravillous trophoblastic cell just surround the spiral arteries. They are just surrounding the spiral arteries. and the endovascular extravillous trophoblasts just invade inside the spiral artery. They are just invading inside the spiral artery, and what they are doing there, they are just forming the cellular plug there. And once they form cellular plug, the cell undergoes into the apoptosis, that is the programmed cell death, and these cells, that is the lining of the vessels, the endothelial as well as the smooth muscle and the connective tissues, now these all cells are replaced by this cytotrophoblastic layer. Okay, so these all cell which lines the vessels, these are replaced by the fibrinoid tissues. So this type of invasion is going to be take place in a two wave. First appear at the time of post fertilization till it is appearing within 12 week of gestation. So in a 12 week of gestation, like in this, you can see the end of first trimester, it is just invading in the destule lining itself. It is just invading the spiral arteries at the level of destula, or you can say the endometrium. But in mid gestation, the second wave appears, and in second wave, mid trimester to the third trimester, around 12 to 16 week of gestation, these cytotrophoblastic cells, that is the endovascular as well as the interstitial cells, these all invade inside the spiral arteries as well as these goes up to the radial artery, as I already show you what is the radial artery. So why there is a need of invasion till the radial artery? So later on in the pregnancy, what is happening, these vessels become more dilated, and there is a high flow system and low resistance system. So the blood is coming in the placenta, that is in the intervillous space, is in good amount to exchange the nutrient and the waste in between the mother as well as the fetus. So here you can see the large bore uteroplacental arteries, that is the funneling of arteries is going to be take place, where in this previous image you can see that there is high flow system and there is more resistance, but once the vessels become dilated in that condition, the flow become more and the resistance become low. So it is very important, because if it does not happen in the second wave, in that condition what will be happen, the mother may have the pregnancy induced hypertension, or fetal may have intrauterine growth retardation, or maybe premature infants. So this is very important to increase the blood supply toward the fetus. So there are some type of decidual natural killer cell which are present in the decidual lining, and these decidual natural killer cell are completely different from the cells which are circulate in the peripheral system, because they just help the cytotrophoblastic cells to invade, and also they help in the formation of new blood vessels, that is the angiogenesis. So these DNK are directly comes in contact with the trophoblastic cell in this decidua and help them to penetrate these vessels. So here also you can see, this is the normal condition in which what is happening, the first wave is invading inside the spiral arteries during first trimester, and in later trimester the cytotrophoblastic invasion is proceeding into the radial arteries also, so to create a large bore uteroplacental arteries. But in preeclampsia, what is happening, the second wave is not appearing in the myometrial lining, so the vessels become narrower, they are not dilating, so the resistance is higher and the flow is reduced in the preeclamptic woman. Now as the blood is coming through these spiral arteries, why it is not going directly inside these veins? Because the blood which is coming inside the intervillous space is under higher pressure, that is about 70 to 80 mm of Hg, and this, with this higher pressure, the blood goes directly downward, and once it touches the coronic plate, then it laterally disperses and mixes slowly, and then it goes up and finally it drains inside the uterine vein. And the pressure within the uterine vein is 8 mm of Hg, and the pressure within the arteries is about 70 to 80 mm of Hg. At the time of uterine contraction also, the fetus receives their nutrition. How? The uterine artery, that is the spiral artery, is perpendicular to the uterine wall, and this spiral vein is parallel to the uterine wall. So at the time of contraction also, the arteries become open and the flow system is continuous. So the blood is coming from the mother is continuously, but the rate is slightly slower. So at the time of contraction also, the fetus is receiving the oxygen as well as the nutrient from the mother, But at the time of contraction, the vein become occluded. So the blood which come from the artery remain there in the intervillous space. At that time, the fetus receiving their nutrition and exchanging their waste. Once the contraction over and the relaxation starts, and at the time of relaxation, the veins become reopened and the blood finally drains inside the vein. So this is how the uteroplacental circulation establishes. So at the time of contraction, the pressure within the intervillous space is about 30 to 50 mm of Hg. And at the time of relaxation, the pressure within the intervillous space is about 10 to 15 mm of Hg. Now, the next is the fetoplacental circulation, in which what is happening? The blood flow comes from the fetus and then it goes inside the placenta and exchange occur. They receive nutrition, they receive oxygen, they remove their waste and finally come back into the fetal body. So that is called the fetoplacental circulation. In that, what is happening? The blood which is coming from the fetus is highly deoxygenated. So the deoxygenated blood is coming through the two umbilical arteries, and once the umbilical artery insert inside the umbilical cord, in this figure you can see, they reaches in the coronic plate, and in the coronic plate they forms the coronic vessels. After coronic vessel, they form smaller branches inside the villous system, primary, secondary and tertiary. And as the tertiary villous system forms the capillary bed over here, and these capillary bed again shunts blood inside the venous system, and these smaller venous channels drain inside the coronic vessel, and these coronic vessel finally merge to form the umbilical vein. So what is happening in the fetal circulation? The deoxygenated blood is coming from the fetus. They form here the capillary network, and this flow system is just opposed to the maternal circulation, and they are flowing side by side, and this counter current flow help them to exchange their waste as well as the nutrient between this placental barrier. So the oxygen as well as the nutrient is flowing inside this villous system, and the waste as well as the carbon dioxide are just exchanging outside this villous system. So this is how the exchange takes place, and again with a higher concentration of oxygen, they merge together, and these plexuses carries blood through a single umbilical vein, and that umbilical vein carries oxygenated blood or the nutrient rich blood toward the fetus. So about 400 ml of fetal blood is flowing inside the placenta in a minute, and the pressure within this capillary system is about 20 to 40 mm of Hg, and the blood which is coming inside this villous system by umbilical artery is under the pressure of 60 mm of Hg, and the blood which is going again toward the fetus by umbilical vein is under the 10 mm of Hg pressure. So this was about the placental circulation. Thank you for watching this video.